Hello students, welcome to the lecture on entrepreneurial behavior and motivation. And after this lecture, we will be able to learn the following objectives. Explain entrepreneurial behavior and motivation. Discuss an achievement and management success. Understand the entrepreneurial success in rural areas. Describe establishing entrepreneurial system. Define the innovation and entrepreneur. Let's start with some introduction. In common perception, entrepreneurs are after money and they engage in profit making. Everybody works for money, but people certainly do not work for money alone. After all, money is required not for its own sake, but for the sake of the needs of the person that it can fulfill. Money, thus, is not the need as such. This leads us to the needs framework of studying entrepreneurial motivation. This framework serves the important purpose of enabling us to understand what motivates an entrepreneur. Let's move on. Let's move on to the next topic, entrepreneurial behavior and motivation. Let's look at the points which explains that how entrepreneurial motivation influences entrepreneurial behavior. Need for achievement. David McClelland has developed an achievement motivation theory in the early 1960s. According to this theory, an individual's need for achievement refers to the need for personal accomplishment. It is the drive to excel, to strive for success, and to achieve in relation to a set of standards. People with high achievement motive like to take calculated risk and want to win. They like to take personal responsibility for solving problems and want to know how well they are doing. The following psychological factors contribute to entrepreneurial motivation: need for achievement through self-study, goal setting, and interpersonal support. Keen interest in situations involving moderate risk. Desire for taking personal responsibility. Concrete measures to task performance. Anticipation of future possibilities. Energetic or novel instrumental activity. Organizational skill. Locus of control closely related to the concept of a high need for achievement is the belief in an internal locus of control. Individuals who are reluctant in believing in their ability to control the environment, though their actions would also be expected to be reluctant to assume the risks that starting a business entails. Risk-taking. Risk-bearing is a prime factor in the entrepreneurial character and function. In particular, Hull and colleagues found that the personality characteristics most important in identifying entrepreneurial types of individuals are functional task preference and personality constructs of creativity, risk, and flexibility. Values. Any consideration of personality characteristics of the entrepreneur must entail restriction of inheritance to a limited class of descendants for at least several generations. The object of entail is to preserve large estates and land from the disintegration that is caused by equal inheritance by all the heirs and by the ordinary and examination of their value systems. Value orientation, the principle of right and wrong that are accepted by an individual or a social group, the Puritan ethic, a person with old-fashioned values, ethic, moral principle, value system. One of the major studies of personal values of entrepreneurs was done by Hornaday and Baud. Problem-solving style and innovativeness. Gartner refers to innovation as the central value of the entrepreneurial behavior, since it is successfully taking an idea or invention to market. Innovation and problem-solving capabilities are expected to be the core of the entrepreneurial capability of an entrepreneur. But the level of innovation is dependent upon the entrepreneur's formal education and managerial experience. David McClelland has developed an achievement motivation theory in the early 1960s. According to this theory, an individual's need for achievement refers to the need for personal accomplishment. It is the drive to excel, to strive for success, and to achieve in relation to a set of standards. High achievers are not motivated by money. such people strive for personal achievement rather than the rewards of success. They want to do something better and more efficiently than it has done before. High achievers are not gamblers. They dislike succeeding by chance. They prefer the challenge of working at a problem and accepting the personal responsibility for success or failure rather than leaving the outcome to chance or the actions of others. The cultural basis of the achievement is motive. In some cultures, failure is seen as a positive learning experience, while in others, it has a certain negative stigma. There is, however, some empirical support for the idea that entrepreneurs have a higher motive to achieve compared to non-entrepreneurs. Now let us discuss about the entrepreneurial success in rural areas. The traditional approach to rural development was top-down, meaning that central development authorities designed programs which brought infrastructure, human capital, and investment from outside the rural community. The new approach which emerged over the past decade is the development from below. It stressed the importance of community development based on local entrepreneurial initiatives with the explicit goal to ensure balanced technological development or rural areas which would offer adequate employment opportunities and a quality of life comparable to urban areas. This approach assumes that the development of rural areas is based on stimulating local entrepreneurial talent and subsequent growth of indigenous companies. Specifically, to accelerate economic development in a rural area, it is necessary to increase the supply of entrepreneurs, that is to build up the critical mass of first-generation entrepreneurs who will take risks and accept the uncertainties of new venture creation and who will by their example stimulate an autonomous entrepreneurial process, thereby ensuring continuous rural development. To support such development, the community must develop links among key institutions, a vibrant entrepreneurial spirit, and a commitment and dedication to risk-taking and risk-sharing, following other requirements of entrepreneurial success in rural area.
Across all infrastructure sectors, water, energy, transport, and social services, governments face an ever-growing dilemma. Traditional public procurement falls short of bridging the gap between available public finances and infrastructure development needs, both in advanced and developing countries. However, there is a way out. Public-private partnerships. Let's illustrate this with a concrete example. Imagine, you have just taken office as a public decision maker. The first thing you would like to improve is the municipal drinking water provision, which has been neglected in the past due to the enormous task that it presents, building and efficiently managing the municipal water and sewage infrastructure. To tackle this challenge, you decide to share not only the construction of the municipal water and sewage system, but also its financing and its operation with the private sector through a public-private partnership agreement. Public-private partnership does not mean the privatization of your water services. In a PPP, the state continues to be the owner of the water infrastructure and accountable for the provision of good drinking water to the people. With the PPP approach, your government sets the stage and drafts a first plan. You then launch a competitive tender to identify the best offer from a private partner who will finance, design, build, operate, and maintain the project. Your private partner recovers his initial investment through service fees paid by the government or by the users directly. Your role is to supervise the public service provision in the best interest of your citizens. The public-private partnership approach lets you plan your project over its entire life cycle, optimizing the use of available resources. With this approach, you tap the strengths of the private sector that knows better how to first attract and invest capital, how to avoid cost overruns, and lastly, how best to operate. Finally, public-private partnership allocates specific risks to the partner that's in a better position to manage them, and these are tailored to the individual project. You, as the public actor, are best suited to control such risks as permits, legal frameworks, and changes in jurisdiction and regulation. The private sector mitigates best risks related to design, cost-efficient investment, operation, and technology. Certain risks have to be shared between both the public and private sectors, for example, sufficient user demand for new projects, or force majeure. Public-private partnerships are complex legal and financial arrangements. To create a successful partnership, a government should implement a set of good governance principles. The most important of these are: put people first. Start with assessing user needs. Projects must be economically warranted and involve all concerned stakeholders. A competent and stable government partner is required to build administrative capacity for effectively negotiating and managing long-term collaborations with the private sector, to put in place adequate legal frameworks and regulations, and ensure transparent procurement policies. Assess all risks from the outset and allocate them appropriately between the public and the private sectors. Don't forget to mitigate any substantial risk to the environment. Public-private partnership can be compared to a football game, where the government sets the rules and acts as referee to ensure their compliance. Those in the private sector are then able to compete against each other on the football field, for the benefit of the spectators. The game ends with the expiry of the PPP contract and the handing over of the public service back into your hands. If your citizens were satisfied with the game, why not continue and organise the next tournament with fresh players?
Public-private institutions. Partnership. One of the principal challenges of economic development of rural areas is the development of a socio-economic environment that would be attractive to people. To meet this challenge, all available and hidden development potential of the local community must be mobilized. This, in turn, requires an environment favorable to entrepreneurship, which a community basically can create in two ways. First, the community should utilize all the available incentives provided by the government to stimulate the development of economically depressed areas. Second, the community should create and foster the development of institutions and a variety of partnerships to support local development. As experience shows, personal and organizational networks are very effective in achieving broad and fast-growing regional economic development. Today, we are witnessing many examples of institutional developments that are fostering businesses and community collaborative efforts while nurturing positive government, academic, business relations in promoting economic growth. Among the most important are institutions of education and training, inter-firm institutions and financial institutions. Institutions of education. The role of institutions of education in rural development is of crucial importance. They help to create a capable labor force and to maintain a skilled workforce in the community. In rural areas, they can act as agents of change, such as redesigning curricula to teach students high-level skills and those skills that would help to upgrade businesses, developing technical training programs to provide people with basic skills for jobs required by local businesses, developing and implementing programs to improve the competitiveness of local firms and their ability to expand into new markets, and developing links with other higher educational institutions, especially with universities outside the rural region, in order to bring into the region technical expertise available outside the region and which could be beneficial to the existing businesses in the region, to new community enterprises or to stimulate new entrepreneurship in the community. Interfirm institutions' efforts to support and enhance existing businesses within a community and to promote new enterprises in a community can be most successfully earned out through different interfirm institutions. Among different firm institutions, business incubators, industrial parks, different non-profit seeking organizations, facilitating networking, and business support centers are one of the most successful ones promoting the growth of new and existing enterprises.
One of the things companies might want to do when they're starting up is look at ways to get from idea to their business faster. One of those ways is through a business incubator. So what is a business incubator? It's typically focused on early stage companies, pre-revenue. You're closer to the idea stage than actual company. And it's very focused on office space. Most incubators give you a small office or cubicle. It's typically a cheaper rent, so often free or very cheap compared to market rates. An internet connection, conference room, copier, the kinds of things you'd expect in an office. Who would run those? There's landlords who are trying to help spur companies in their areas. There's economic development agencies, cities, counties, people who are just trying to make new companies in their area. The other thing they provide is they often provide resources, things like referrals, that is to service providers, the attorneys, and the other people that you might need to work with as a startup, and also to mentors, other people who've been through business and might be able to help you with your business. So, you know, business incubators are one way you might be able to take your idea and make it a business.
Business incubators. So what are business incubators? Business incubators are a facility designed to assist the development of new enterprises. They help entrepreneurs by providing them with services, with support, and complement their own talents and abilities. Their support system usually includes secretarial, administrative, and business expertise and facilities which are available to entrepreneurs below or at market rates. The entrepreneurs receive not only help regarding the management of their enterprises, but also other services such as provision of financial assistance and training. They organize conferences, business luncheons, and different types of activities for the purpose of networking. The business incubator presents a rather unique approach to economic development. Unique in the sense that it is an independent enterprise whose business is the process of incubating enterprises. The business incubator industry was one of the fastest growing industries in the late 80s in the USA. Business incubators are usually established by private initiative with the financial assistance from the federal, state, and local governments and private sector contributions. Industrial parks, as an unemployment reducing effort and or revitalizing the community economic base, communities could establish industrial parks by purchasing marginal agricultural property at the market price and converting it to the industrial purposes in order to accelerate entrepreneurial restructuring of rural communities. Communities could increase the attractiveness of industrial parks to potential entrepreneurs by delivering conventional common infrastructural services by customizable layouts that could be rearranged over time to meet user needs in a flexible way and by the final price, which should be much lower than the price of equivalent buildings in other, especially urban areas. Institutions facilitating networking. These are non-profit seeking associations, registered or non-registered, which facilitate networking between small firms located in the same region. They usually perform the following tasks: promote cooperation between small firms in the network, thus promoting their competitive efficiency. Provide different services in the areas of finance, marketing, research, and development. provide common services of daily matters in production and administration in order to reduce transaction costs. Business support centers. Business support centers can be established to meet the needs of startups, emerging or established businesses. They provide different types of services according to the needs of the three different clients. Assistance to startups. Business planning and finance. Assistance to emerging and established businesses. Assistance to business partnership, subcontracting of local firms with larger enterprises outside the community. Business support centers can be part of the local government or semi-private institutions or for non-profit private organizations. Financial institutions. Communities should support the development of a strong venture capital base and risk capital network specializing in funding new entrepreneurial activities. Seed financing could be an important bottleneck for new enterprise creation. For this reason, special attention must be given to the creation of institutions that provide seed financing and startups targeting venture capital and are engaged in equity financing. Let's now talk about establishing the entrepreneur system. An entrepreneur perceives an opportunities for marketing a product or services. Then he establishes a business unit on the basis of his, her perception. Finally, he manages his enterprise expanding, growing or diversifying over a period of time. In order to establish an entrepreneurial system, an entrepreneur needs to take the following steps. Search for business ideas. The first step of entrepreneurial system is search for business ideas. The idea may originate from various sources, example, success story of a friend or relative, demand for certain products, visits to trade fairs and exhibitions, study of project files and industrial potential surveys, meetings with government agencies, etc. Sources of ideas. A business idea may be discovered from the following sources. Observing markets. Careful observation of markets can reveal a business idea. Market surveys can also reveal the demand and supply position for various products. Prospective consumers. Consumers know best what he wants and the habits, tastes which are going to be popular in near future. Development in other nations. People in underdeveloped countries generally follow the fashion trends of developed countries. For example, video, washing machines, micro ovens, etc., which are now in things in India, were being used in the United States and Europe. Study of projects, files. Various government and private agencies publish periodic profiles of various projects and industries. These profiles describe in detail the technical, financial, and market requirement and prevailing position. A careful scrutiny of such project profiles is very helpful in choosing the line of business. Process the ideas. Once business ideas are discovered, screening and testing of these ideas is done. Technical feasibility. It refers to the possibility of producing the product. Technical feasibility of an idea is judged in terms of availability of necessary technology, machinery and equipment, labor skills and raw materials. Commercial viability. A cost-benefit analysis is required to ascertain the profitability of the ideas. An elaborate study of market conditions and prevailing situation is made to assess the viability and prospectus of the proposed projects. Idea selection. The feasibility report is analyzed to finally choose the most promising idea. Input requirement. Once the promoter is convinced of the feasibility and profitability of the project, he assembles the necessary resources to launch the enterprise. Establish the enterprise. This is the last step of entrepreneurial system. It is a very important step. In this phase, the entrepreneur integrates their resources and establishes the enterprise. Let us now discuss about innovation and entrepreneur now. Innovation is the central value of the entrepreneurial behavior, since it is successfully taking an idea or invention to market. Innovation and problem-solving capabilities are expected to be the core of entrepreneurial capability of an entrepreneur. The vast majority of entrepreneurs studied were characterized by sensation thinking, problem-solving styles. Such individuals were shown to be short-term oriented, dealing with immediate problems. Entrepreneurs are faced with a number of challenges as they try to implement new ideas. Innovation is one of the central characteristics of entrepreneurial endeavor. The features of innovation are: innovations are the harbingers of change. Innovations can take place at the spark of light or can take a generation of experiments. Innovations can be both revolutionary as well as an extension to the existing products. Innovations provide a USP to a business. Innovations are action-oriented, that is, active and searching new ideas. Innovations help in making the product, service, or process simple and understandable. Innovations help in making the product, service, or process customer-based. Innovation is all about trying, testing, and revising. Thus, innovation refers to a process of creation of a product that can solve existing problems or tap opportunities. Sources of innovation: present and potential customers, existing companies, raw material provider, distributors and retailers, research and development, existing employees.
Innovation. Building on human knowledge is changing the way business invests and grows. Just as coal drove the last industrial revolution, software, databases, research and development, new business models, and the skills people bring to an organization are driving revolutionary changes today. Take Apple's iPhone. In the US, when you buy a $600 iPhone, you're paying $270 for the design, marketing, and distribution, $80 to the Korean company that makes the components, but only $6.50 to the Chinese firm that assembles it. Some developed economies now invest more in ideas and skills and other non-physical things, which together we can call knowledge-based capital, than in physical capital, like machines and equipment. For more than 20 years, the United States has been investing a larger portion of its GDP on knowledge capital than on physical capital. The value of many of the world's leading firms is now in their knowledge capital. For example, around only 5% of Google's value is in its physical assets. The rest is in knowledge assets, like their algorithms, their people, and their patents. Even traditionally blue-collar industries like the automotive sector are becoming more knowledge-intensive. General Motors' electric hybrid car, the Chevrolet Volt, contains 10 million lines of software code. And companies are generating and collecting ever more data. In 2010, worldwide data storage capacity exceeded 1,000 billion gigabytes, nearly 200 CD-ROMs for every person on the planet. And that's forecast to double every year. More information and more data means more opportunity to diagnose diseases or better meet the needs of customers, or manage traffic flows in environmentally friendly ways. Managed properly, the knowledge revolution can benefit everyone. Many governments are rightly focusing on education, giving citizens the skills that businesses need. To promote long-term growth and the jobs of tomorrow, governments must ensure that policies facilitate business investment in knowledge-based capital. They can target tax support in efficient ways. They can help create value from data. They can help companies experiment and invest in new ideas. And they can also better protect intellectual.
Entrepreneurial support system, it is very difficult and complicated to create a system for entrepreneurs. While public officials and service providers understand the differences between, say, a small business center and a small business technology development center and the services they offer, entrepreneurs do not. Nor should we expect entrepreneurs to understand these differences. Thus, when an entrepreneur seeks assistance and is referred to some other office, her typical response is intense frustration. These problems emerge because most service providers focus correctly on market niches. Small Business Development Centers, SBDCs, focus on growth businesses. The Cooperative Extension Services focuses on agriculture, and micro loan programs provide more general support to new entrepreneurs. While there are efficiencies that arise from this specialized approach, the system specialization often gets lost in translation to the entrepreneur. Most entrepreneurs simply want help. They do not care which agency or program provides it. One-stop shop to no wrong door. This type of sophisticated businesses diagnosis system does not really exist today for most entrepreneurs. High-growth technology businesses can receive such support from venture investors and others, but most entrepreneurs make do with one-size-fits-all programs for training, financing, and the like. In practice, this means that business owners often receive the services that are available instead of the services that are needed. What does an entrepreneur support system look like? Many regions claim that they have a small business support system in place, but most cases, these systems are simply a loose federation of non-profits and other support providers. A true system links all relevant service providers, operates according to common procedures, and offers a customized and comprehensive set of public and private services for local entrepreneurs. Several characteristics are essential. Common intake procedures. All local service providers are trained to perform a brief intake and diagnosis of an entrepreneur's issues and service needs. Thus, when an entrepreneur calls a service provider, she is not given an immediate referral. Instead, her basic information is obtained and entered into the system. Clear referral systems. Referrals are the cornerstone of the system. The process must be clear to both entrepreneurs and service providers. Clear guidelines for entrepreneurs. As noted above, the system must be understandable to entrepreneurs. They must understand the purpose of the initial diagnostic process and why they have been referred to a certain service provider. Regular collaboration. The system will work if the partners effectively collaborate with one another. They must meet on a regular basis and regularly review how the system is serving local businesses. Program offerings. Every region must develop its own set of program offerings targeted to the needs of local entrepreneurs. Some of the key program offerings to be found in comprehensive entrepreneur development systems. Access to capital. Sources of capital to match the financing needs of entrepreneurs at various stages of development, from seed capital to loans to equity. Access to networks. Opportunities for entrepreneurs to connect with peers and mentors and to form strategic alliances to benefit their businesses. Entrepreneurial culture. A culture that recognizes, embraces, and celebrates entrepreneurs, creating a place where entrepreneurs choose to live, work, and play. The benefits creating an effective entrepreneur support system can generate huge benefits for local business owners and aspiring entrepreneurs. It can also stimulate a transformation for economic developers. By promoting real collaboration, it improves productivity and program effectiveness while also generating improved outcomes in terms of jobs, new businesses, and overall quality of life. Now in the end, let us summarize what we have learned in this chapter. Value orientation, the principles of right and wrong that are accepted by an individual or a social group. National and international trade fairs are a very good source of business ideas. Innovation is the central value of the entrepreneurial behavior, since it is successfully taking an idea or intervention to market. Business support centers are the part of the local government or semi-private institutions or for non-profit private organizations. An entrepreneur perceives an opportunity for good marketing a product or services. The traditional approach to rural development was top-down, meaning that central development authorities designed programs which brought in infrastructure, human capital, and investment from outside the rural community.